Okay, thank you. All right, let's look a little background. It's always good to understand biblically a little more what's going on. So my first question when I read this is, how old was Joshua? I don't know if any of you have any idea how old Joshua was in this record, or how old he was with, we'll look at some of the things that he actually saw and experienced that made him the man of God that he was. But let's look at a couple of scriptures related to how old he was. And you can read them off of here, or you can look them up in your phone or in your Bible, whichever you like. But Joshua 24:29, we'll look at Joshua 24 at the very end. It's the last chapter of Joshua. But it says, "Now it came to pass after these things that Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died being 110 years old." Okay? So at his death, he was 110. Right? Next fact. The time period of the book of Joshua, actually, Pastor Harry mentioned this last week, that he said 25 years. The information I got was about 17 years that it took them to conquer the land. So the book of Joshua took 17 years, right? That's a 17-year time period. So that makes Joshua, at the time we read this, Joshua chapter 1, that puts him in his early 90s. He's like 93 years old when he starts into the promised land. And we'll see later what sorts of armies, what sorts of men he's leading, the numbers, okay? And again, this is just background on Joshua as a man, because we'll see later, Moses, his, you know, really mentor, changed his name from Hoshea to Joshua. That was a great point Pastor Harry made last week. Great point, because Hoshea simply means savior. Joshua means, you can look at it different ways in Hebrew, but it really means the man by whom God will save. So Joshua's name that we'll see at the very first time we see him in Scripture. Kind of the second time we see him in Scripture, Moses changes his name to Joshua. So he has years beforehand. I mean, remember, and we'll look at chronology, but years beforehand, 40 years in the wilderness, before he gets to the point of Joshua chapter 1. So he's in his early 90s in Joshua chapter 1. Look at Deuteronomy 8:2. "And you shall remember that the Lord your God led you all the way these 40 years in the wilderness to humble you and to test you, to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or no." I point that out because, remember, they were 40 years in the wilderness. We'll see later that was not God's will for them. That is not what he wanted. But that's what they brought on themselves by their attitude toward God's promises, which is a great life lesson for us as well. We'll look at that a little later. So 40 years in the wilderness. He's 93 at Joshua 1. 40 years back, he's about 53 years old when all this stuff, the stuff we'll read about tonight, all of the background that makes Joshua the Joshua that we read about, all the stuff that happened in Egypt, all the stuff that happened in the wilderness for 40 years. And I don't know if you all have ever read these records, but if you haven't, I really encourage you to read the records of the Exodus, of the Passover. There is, I think, an attitude among Christian believers that those books are kind of boring, that there's a whole lot of chronology. So-and-so begat, so-and-so begat, so-and-so begat, so-and-so. These records are absolutely electric. We'll see some of this tonight. They're just electric. They're fabulous records. Okay, let's go on. And then, so Joshua was in his early 50s when the Exodus began. So in Exodus chapter 7, verse 7, Moses was 80 years old and Aaron was 83 years old when they first spoke to Pharaoh. Okay, so when the stuff we read about at the beginning of the book of Exodus, Moses is 80 years old. Aaron, by the way, was Moses' brother, older brother. We'll read about another spot tonight, I think, Numbers chapter 12. We'll read about Miriam. Miriam was Moses' sister. We'll see how that, in that record, how that goes, but so Moses was 27 years older than Joshua was. The reason I point that out is Moses, well, I think it's safe to say that any man becomes the man he is because of the situation he grew up in, the mentors he had or didn't have, the people you looked up to or you didn't look up to. I mean, those you looked up to, you knew what you wanted to be. Those you didn't look up to, you knew what you didn't want to be. Everybody becomes who they are, at least initially, because of how they grow up, what kind of situation you grow up in, including the mentors that you have. For Joshua, Moses was a mentor. He was essentially, you know, about as old as I am older than my oldest son. Okay, so he was a father figure. He was a mentor. When Joshua was 53 and the book of Exodus is starting, as all those events you read about, Moses is 80 years old. Okay, so you'll see that as you read this stuff, and if you go back and read these records, we'll see it some tonight, you'll see as you read these records, Moses trained Joshua to get him to the point of Joshua chapter 1. Be strong and of a good courage. You're going to take the children of Israel into the promised land. And I think it's important to remember, again, because you are who you are, I am who I am, because of partly how you were raised. The only life Joshua ever knew up until his early 50s was captivity in Israel. The only thing he knew was the Israelites being told what to do, and it even getting worse after the Exodus event started. Okay? That's the only life he ever knew. He never knew anything else. They were in, the Israelites were in Egypt for about 400 years or 430 years, depending on how you where the starting point is, something like that. So that's the only life he ever knew. And then let's look at Moses a little bit. Let's just look at the character of Moses. Again, if you haven't read some of this stuff, I encourage you to do that. Numbers chapter 12, verses 6 through 8. And this is God speaking, by the way. We ought to read this record. This is a fairly short chapter. I'd like to just read this record with you. If you would turn to Numbers chapter 12, this is a great, great record. It points out a great point about Moses and how close a relationship he had with the Lord God. Numbers chapter 12. This record happened before the children of Israel got to the point of sending spies into the promised land and before they decided they weren't going to believe God's promise of giving them the promised land. This record happens before that. So they're on their way to where God's going to send them into the promised land. This record happens before that. So, Numbers chapter 12, verse 1. Then Miriam, again, that's Moses' sister, and Aaron spoke against Moses because of the Ethiopian woman whom he had married, for he had married an Ethiopian woman. So they said, has the Lord indeed spoken only through Moses? Has he not spoken through us also? And the Lord heard it. Now the man Moses was very humble, more than all men who were on the face of the earth. Great life lesson there. Yeah. Well, he didn't write this, but I understand. Okay, verse 4. Suddenly the Lord, now, and notice how the Lord acts here. I'm not going to point out all of the particulars, but just watch how the Lord acts here. Suddenly the Lord said to Moses, Aaron, and Miriam, come out, you three, to the tabernacle of meeting. So the three came out. Then the Lord came down in the pillar of cloud and stood in the door of the tabernacle and called Aaron and Miriam, and they both went forward. Then he said, hear now my words. If there is a prophet among you, I, the Lord, make myself known to him in a vision. I speak to him in a dream. Not so with my servant Moses. He is faithful in all my house. I speak with him face to face, even plainly, and not in dark sayings, and he sees the form of the Lord. Why then were you not afraid to speak against my servant Moses? Exactly. Now, I can't begin to imitate what the Lord God's voice really sounded like, but just imagine that you're standing there and he's talking directly to you, because that's what this was. Verse 9. Audibly, not that I know of. Now, he spoke audibly lots of times. They may have heard that, but in this kind of direct address, I don't think so. Verse 9. So the anger of the Lord was aroused against them, and he departed. And when the cloud departed from above the tabernacle, suddenly Miriam became leprous, as white as snow. Well, let me point out one little fact here. You'll notice in verse 1 it says Miriam and Aaron, right? From the order that they appear, and the fact that a little thing about Hebrew verbs is that they can have gender. The verb can be masculine or feminine, which means the verb could refer to a man or a woman, right? The verb here, the Hebrew verb, is feminine. So it appears Miriam was the instigator here. Miriam was the first one to say, Wait a minute, does the Lord only speak by Moses? I think he can speak by us too. Remember, Aaron was the high priest. He was Moses' spokesman in Egypt. I don't know if you read that, in the beginning part of Exodus. Aaron was his spokesman anyway. But from the way this record reads, it would appear that Miriam, his sister, was the one who instigated this. What's that? Yeah. we'll have a little cartoon about that later. Okay, so verse 10. And when the cloud departed from above the tabernacle, suddenly Miriam became leprous, as white as snow. Then Aaron turned toward Miriam, and there she was, a leper. The other reason that it seems like it was more Miriam is that she's the one that's for whom there is a consequence. For Aaron, there's no consequence here. For Miriam, there is. Okay. So Aaron said to Moses, verse 11, "Oh, my Lord, please do not lay this sin on us in which we have done foolishly and in which we have sinned. Please do not let her be as one dead whose flesh is half consumed when he comes out of his mother's womb." What he is referring to, if you look up, maybe do a Google search if you want to, for leprosy. Leprosy can result literally in limbs falling off. I mean, it decays the flesh such that a limb will actually fall off. So that's what he's talking about. So Moses cried out to the Lord, saying, "Please heal her, O God, I pray." Then the Lord said to Moses, "If her father had but spit in her face, would she not be ashamed 7 days? Let her be shut out of the camp 7 days, and afterward she may be received again." So Miriam was shut out of the camp 7 days, and the people did not journey till Miriam was brought in again, and afterward the people moved from Hazeroth and camped in the wilderness of Paran. Anyway, great record about Moses, meekest man on the face of the earth. In any case, the one thing I wanted to point out to you is that Moses, as a man of God, Young's literal translation translates this part of this verse, "They spoke mouth to mouth, I speak to him, and by an appearance." Let's look at another couple of scriptures about Moses. Exodus 33:11. "So the Lord spoke to Moses face to face, as a man speaks to his friend." And this is an interesting part of this verse. This is Joshua. This is the thing about Joshua. "And he would return to the camp," Moses, "but his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, did not depart from the tabernacle." Joshua had his own hunger for the Lord. You see it in that verse. Okay? But Moses spoke to God face to face. I can't even imagine that. Deuteronomy 34:10. "But since then," remember, Deuteronomy 34 is where Moses dies. Okay? So, "but since then there has not arisen in Israel a prophet like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face." Now, this is Joshua's mentor, Moses. What Joshua sees from his early 50s on is Moses coming into Egypt, Moses speaking for God, all of the miracles which we'll look at that happened, plagues, et cetera, to get the children of Israel to the point of the promised land. And that's where we pick him up in Joshua chapter 1. Now that's, again, a good solid 40-year period you're looking at of Joshua's life. When he sees these miracles, when he's mentored by Moses, and when he's hardened by his experience, we'll look at some of that as well. This is all, again, it's just background to understand how you get to the point of Joshua chapter 1 and what Joshua is going to do there. So a little more about Moses, Numbers 13, 16. I won't read these chapters with you. Part of it I will, but I really encourage you to read Numbers 13 and 14, because Numbers 13 and 14 are the record of the children of Israel getting to the point of the promised land. They get to a place called Kadesh Barnea, right? And they're ready to go. We'll read it a little later. God is ready to send them into the promised land. It says it's there. Moses says it's there. Just go, right? But they decide, and this is the people's decision. They decide, let's send spies in. Let's let them kind of take a look and see where we should go, where we shouldn't go. Now, please understand or remember, God didn't need this. God doesn't need spies to look at the promised land. This was for the people, right? We'll read it in Deuteronomy chapter 1. The people requested this. Let's send spies in. So they did that. Numbers 13 and 14 is the record of the spies going in, one of which was Joshua, and the spies coming back. The report they gave, 10 of them, not so good, 2 of them, we got this. and then how the people reacted to that, and then how God reacted to how the people reacted. That's Numbers 13 and 14. I don't know if we'll read the whole thing, but anyway, in Numbers 13, 16, these are the names of the men whom Moses sent to spy out the land, and Moses called Hoshea, the son of Nun, Joshua. That's where he gets the name change. That's not the first time we see him in Scripture, but that's, but the way, and also just to point out, just because it says Moses called Hoshea the son of Nun Joshua doesn't mean he changed his name at this time. It simply means that's what he called him. The name change could have happened long before that. But this is where they note the fact that Hoshea is Joshua, not that it occurred at this time. Okay? Exodus 17, 14, then the Lord said to Moses, write this for a memorial in the book and recount it in the hearing of Joshua. Now, the only reason I point that out, Exodus 17 is the first place we see Joshua in Scripture. First instance we see him is Exodus 17 when Moses says to him, take some men, go fight the Amalekites. That's the first time we see Joshua, right? And it's then, even from that point, that the Lord tells Moses, write this in a book, you rehearse it in Joshua's ears. This is a good solid, well, decades before what we read about in Joshua chapter 1. He's going to rehearse these victories. He's going to rehearse this stuff that God does for his people. And we'll see more about that when we look at the word meditate in Joshua chapter 1. Okay. So now we're going to, another thing that I guess was sort of a learning experience, but a molding experience for Joshua were the plagues. Now, everybody knows about the plagues, right? That there were plagues, that there were 10 plagues, you know, so the children of Israel are in Egypt, they're in probably, based on the numbers that we look at in when they come out in Exodus like 13, there were probably 1.5 million of them, or maybe 2 million, possibly, right? They're that strong. They're that kind of a workforce or labor force in Egypt. It says that the children of Israel built Pharaoh two cities, Pithon and Ramses. They were store cities. They built the cities, right? So we're looking at a labor force of a couple of million people that probably, just from an economic point of view, they're the labor force in Egypt. Egypt doesn't want them to go anywhere. So Moses comes in and says, let my people go, right? Pharaoh says, not a chance. Okay, well then Pharaoh needs a little convincing. That's where the plagues come in. Now let's look at some of the plagues. So, and we're just going to read about these. We're not going to read the whole chapters, just the verses. Exodus chapter 7, verses 20, 21, and 25. Moses and Aaron did so just as the Lord commanded. So he lifted up the rod, struck the waters that were in the river, in the sight of Pharaoh, and in the sight of his servants, and all the waters that were in the river were turned to blood. The fish that were in the river died, the river stank, and the Egyptians could not drink the water of the river. So there was blood throughout all the lands of Egypt. And 7 days passed after the Lord had struck the river. That means for 7 days they didn't have any water because it was all turned to blood. Okay? Plague number one. Now, mind you, some of these plagues, the records will indicate that the plagues affected only Egyptians. They did not affect Israelites. Most of the plagues actually affected both. It only mentions 3 or 4 plagues that only affected Egyptians but not Israelites. This would have been, the Israelites would have been affected as well. Next one, Exodus 8, 3 and 14. So the river shall bring forth frogs abundantly, which shall go up and come into your house, into your bedroom, on your bed, into the houses of your servants, on your people, into your ovens and into your kneading bowls. They gathered them together in heaps, and the land stank, okay? So frogs. Now, I want you to see a little more of this. So, actually, we'll do this next one first. So, and just a point about frogs. The Hebrew, if a younger person nowadays especially goes to a party, and it was a really good party, they might say something like, it was way, way cool. Right? Would that be a normal thing to say? And they mean it was very cool, right? But they use the word way twice. And they're just emphasizing the fact it was really cool. The Hebrew here does the same thing. For heaps, the Hebrew in that verse says, they gathered them into heaps, heaps. That's how they're shoveling these things, shoveling dead frogs. There's another great scripture. Hebrew will do this. It's a way we do the same thing in English. Another scripture that comes to mind where this occurs is in Isaiah 26:3. It says, thou shalt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in thee. Perfect peace in English, in Hebrew, is peace, peace. It just means, you know, peace to the nth degree. Emphatic peace, if that's what you want to call it. So these are heaps, heaps. That's the frogs. Next plague. Exodus 8:17. For Aaron stretched out his hand with his rod and struck the dust of the earth, and it became lice on man and beast. All the dust of the land became lice throughout all the land of Egypt. These were, we know, the English translations say lice. They were probably actually mosquito gnats. Okay? And this gets worse. But this is just, and remember now, I put a little asterisk in front of the scriptures when they were distinctive to the Egyptians but not to the Israelites. They didn't affect the Israelites. These plagues all affected the Israelites too. They felt the same thing. So Joshua is part of this. To bring this back home to what we're actually studying tonight, Joshua 1. Joshua is part of this. He lives through this. He's shoveling the frogs. He's whacking the mosquito gnats. He learns this stuff. He hears Moses say, this is what's going to happen, and that's what happened. And then he hears Moses say, okay, you know, Pharaoh pleads and says, oh, stop this. And Moses prays to God, and then it stops. Joshua lives through this stuff. This is Joshua, okay? Now, for a little fun, this is frogs. If you can't see it, you can move up if you want to. I made it as big as I could. Now, just imagine you were in Egypt and they were all over the place. In your house, in your closet, in your bedroom, in your kitchen, in your food, everywhere. Any water they got into, obviously you're not going to drink. And this isn't anything like the amount they would have had. This is just an example of what it would have looked like. Imagine that. Yuck. Okay, so the plagues continued. Right, exactly, yuck. We'll see a little more of that later. So here's another plague. Now, little asterisk, this one was specific only to the Israelites. I'm sorry, to the Egyptians. The Israelites didn't suffer from this one. Exodus 8:24, and the Lord did so. Thick swarms of flies came into the house of Pharaoh, into his servants' houses, all the land of Egypt. The land was corrupted because of the swarms of flies. Okay? So this was actually swarms of all kinds of bugs. It wasn't, in English, we always want the word swarm to have of something. You know, we want to say swarm of flies, swarm of hornets, swarm of something. So they put in flies. You'll notice it's in italics. You may remember with the New King James Version and the King James, if you see something in italics, the translators supplied it because they needed it to make sense, because it wasn't in the original, but it needed to make sense in English. So that's why they added of flies, okay? But these were actually swarms of all kinds of insects. The Hebrew verb that's the root, it means to intermix. It means just swarms. Okay? So that was this plague, but that was only Egyptians, not Israelites. Exodus 9:3, behold, the hand of the Lord will be on your cattle in the field, on the horses, on the donkeys, on the camels, on the oxen, on the sheep, a very severe pestilence. So the Lord did this thing on the next day, and all the livestock of Egypt died. But of the livestock of the children of Israel, not one died. Okay, again, only Egyptians, not Israelites. Remember, all this time, Joshua is learning, observing, and every time, Pharaoh is saying no. He may say yes for a minute, and then he changes his mind and says no. No, you can't leave. So, And this is comic relief. Everybody gets to stand up now.
I just thought you'd get a break.
But then, really, everybody stand up. Stand up, stand up, stand up, stand up, stand up. Put your stuff down. It says, you idiot, he said cast the nets. And he's playing cast the nets. Okay, so turn to somebody beside you and shake their hand. Introduce yourself if you haven't. All right. Okay, so have a seat. Let's get back into the plagues and Joshua's formative years, so to speak. Okay? So we're going to continue with the plagues. Remember, these were formative for Joshua. We're leading up to the Joshua that we read about in Joshua chapter 1. So next plague, Exodus chapter 9, verse 10. Then they took ashes from the furnace and stood before Pharaoh, and Moses scattered them toward heaven, and they caused boils that break out in sores on man and beast. Okay? Next plague, Exodus chapter 9, verse 25. And the hail struck throughout the whole land of Egypt, all that was in the field, both man and beast, and the hail struck every herb of the field and broke every tree of the field. Next plague, that one affected only Egyptians, not Israelites. It's in, you can read it in the record. It isn't in that verse. It's not in that verse, yeah. The reason I noted it there, but you'd have to read a little more in Exodus 9. Yeah. Exodus 10, 14 to 15. And the locusts went up all over all the land of Egypt and rested on all the territory of Egypt. They were very severe. Previously there had been no such locusts as they, nor shall there be such after them. For they covered the face of the whole earth, so that the land was darkened, and they ate every herb of the land and all the fruit of the trees which the hail had left. So there remained nothing green on the trees or on the plants of the field throughout all the land of Egypt. Okay? Now, this is a little more fun, and this is actually real. This really happened in 2013.
And then also
So, you see the truth of that scripture about the locusts and how quickly. At the beginning of that, it said it was about a 45-minute span, and that's what they did. 500 billion locusts is what they numbered them at. And I'm guessing the Egyptian plagues were probably worse. Right? So, another plague. And Joshua, again, is experiencing this, seeing God's power, seeing God's supreme authority, seeing how committed God is, the Elohim, God is, to getting the children of Israel out of Egypt and to the Promised Land. Other than when Jesus Christ actually walked the earth, this 40-year span, roughly, or maybe into the Promised Land, is the most, I think it's accurate to say that biblically, it's the most active you ever see God actually intervening in human affairs, this 40 or 50 years, other than when Jesus Christ actually walked the earth. Okay, so the plagues continued. This particular plague affected only Egyptians, not Israelites. So Moses stretched out his hand toward heaven, and there was thick darkness in the land of Egypt 3 days. They did not see one another, nor did anyone rise from his place for 3 days, but all the children of Israel had light in all their dwellings. Next one, same thing, only affected Egyptians, not Israelites. And it came to pass at midnight that the Lord struck all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh who sat on his throne to the firstborn of the captive who was in the dungeon, and all the firstborn of livestock. That didn't affect Israelites. Right before this was, of course, when God instituted the Passover. Okay. Okay, so that's the plagues. And again, the reason I point those out is those were formative for Joshua. Just like for you and me, how we grew up, the people we had around us, what we experienced, make us many ways. Same for Joshua. So he went through this. He lived through these things. Some of the other things he saw was the Red Sea. Okay, we only think of this as like Cecil B. DeMille or something. I don't know if you've ever watched a movie of this, but that's all we really think of. It was so much more huge than that. We can't possibly imagine. However, so let's just read about that, okay? We're just going to read in Exodus 14, it's like 26 through 31. And again, if you want to, would you rather turn there? Would that be better than reading the screen? Or do you just want to read on the screen? Is that okay? Screen? Okay. So Exodus 14, 26, then the Lord said to Moses, stretch out your hand over the sea, that the waters may come back upon the Egyptians on their chariots and on their horsemen. And Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and when the morning appeared, the sea returned to its full depth while the Egyptians were fleeing into it. So the Lord overthrew the Egyptians in the midst of the sea. Then the waters returned and covered the chariots, the horsemen, and all the army of Pharaoh that came into the sea after them. Not so much as one of them remained. But the children of Israel had walked on dry land in the midst of the sea, and the waters were a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. So the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Thus Israel saw the great work which the Lord had done in Egypt, so the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and his servant Moses. Now, I included that last verse only because, at least right after the Red Sea experience, it says, the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and his servant Moses. Now that's in Exodus 14. When you get Exodus 15 is what's called the Song of Moses, okay? It's just a praise song that Moses and the people sang in response to what God did, God's deliverance. But by the time you get to Exodus 16, which we'll look at just a couple of verses, but by the time you get to Exodus 16, they're starting to complain because they don't have anything to eat. And they're starting to say, what'd you bring us out here to kill us out here for? We could have died back there. I mean, we don't have anything to eat out here. And that's when we see manna starting, okay? But how quickly the people change from, I saw the Egyptians nailed, I believe. But wait a minute, I don't have anything to eat, so I don't believe anymore. Because that's how quickly they change. So I don't know if some of the other things, again, if you haven't read these records, I don't know if you know about some of this stuff, but the way that the Lord God both protected and led the children of Israel was a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. Okay? So we'll read about that, right? And we'll look at these numbers, but again, Exodus 13, and I think Numbers chapter 1 counts the, in what in Hebrew is called Geber, mighty men, which we'll see, you see in Numbers, are men that were 20 years old and could fight. Okay, that's what a mighty man, a Geber, was. Okay, it numbers them at about 600,000 men. Now, that doesn't count the women, the children, or all of those men that weren't Geber men. Right? So, probably safe to say there was at least 1.5 million people that we're talking about here that were coming out of Egypt. If you read the record, it also says they came out with what's called what the King James Version calls a mixed multitude. Essentially, it means those Egyptians that finally decided Pharaoh was crazy, and if I don't leave with them, I'm going to die over there. So they just leave with the Israelites too. So it's not only Israelites and their herds and everything, but it's a bunch of the Egyptians too that are finally saying, you know what, this is not working, I'm going with you. So it's a good solid 1.5, maybe 2 million people that are coming out of Egypt. That's the size of the crowd we're talking about here. So anyway, the cloud by day and pillar of fire by night, I just want you to be aware of, you know, this isn't like a little bitty cloud. This isn't a little bitty fire. This is a lot of people we're talking about here. Exodus 13, 21 and 22, and the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of cloud to lead the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light so as to go by day and night. He did not take away the pillar of cloud by day or the pillar of fire by night from before the people. And then later in Exodus, we read some of the same stuff. Whenever the cloud was taken up from above the tabernacle, the children of Israel would go onward in all their journeys. But if the cloud was not taken up, then they did not journey till the day that it was taken up. For the cloud of the Lord was above the tabernacle by day, and fire was over it by night, in the sight of all the house of Israel throughout all their journeys. They journeyed in one area around Kadesh Barnea when they just kind of went in a circle for 38 years. That's how long this is happening. That's what that record says. Again, all of this is formative for Joshua. The other miracle miracle that I want to point out is manna. I don't know how much you know about that, but you heard about the numbers of people we're talking about, right? So manna, you know, you can read about this in Exodus 16. People complain, we got nothing to eat, okay, fine. Manna. So manna comes down. The Hebrew word manna, some say, means what is it? Because they didn't know what it was. So manna comes down. God designs this. I really encourage you to read this. It's fabulous. God designs this so that 6 days out of 7, they get manna. They're supposed to go out and gather the manna, about a half a gallon per person. You know, like Joel would go out and gather manna for his family. He would gather that much. They would kind of equal out. If Greg didn't get as much, they would kind of equal out. They'd all get about a half a gallon per person, right? But they couldn't let it go until the next day. If they did let it go until the next day, it rotted. Okay, so whatever you got, you ate. Now, on the sixth day, though, you could gather enough for 2 days. Because it didn't come down on the seventh day, you weren't supposed to work on the seventh day, so you didn't go gather. And that, on the seventh day, that lasted, that didn't stink, that didn't rot. Any other day it did, that day it didn't. And it lasted until the next day when you could gather. Okay, that's the way manna worked. Now, remember the numbers. Remember, this happened 6 days out of 7 for 40 years. Just think about that. A miraculous feeding every single day. Now, this will come into play a little later. When I share about Joshua 24, it'll come into play because you see how people reacted to that or didn't. In other words, whether they believed God or they didn't. You know, all the Israelites were exposed to these same miracles. Not everybody reacted like Joshua and the other guy, the other kind of spy that gave a good report was Caleb. Only 10 of them were not good, 2 of them were good, and then all the people followed the 10. They all saw these miracles. They all saw them. All the same eyes, different perspective. Same thing for us. It's the same thing for us. So about manna, Exodus 16, 35 and 36, and the children of Israel ate manna 40 years until they came to an inhabited land. They ate manna until they came to the border of the land of Canaan. Now an omer is a tenth part of an ephah. I put that in there just because of the measurement. An omer is about a half a gallon. Okay, that's how much they gather per man. And again, Pastor Harry pointed out that this stopped. It's the record is in Joshua chapter 5, verse 12. That's when they stopped eating manna, when they got to the promised land. Until then, it was still happening. And again, Joshua sees all this stuff. Another comic relief. This is along your point of another woman. Adam's tombstone, at least my wife could not complain that I never listened to her. Eve's tombstone, I married what used to be the perfect man. Okay, do you want to stand up? Are you sleepy? You okay? All right. So, what sort of man was Joshua? First place we see him in Scripture is Exodus 17. In Exodus 17, 9. And this is the first time you hear the name Joshua, right? Moses turns to Joshua and says, choose some men, go out and fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand. First mention of Joshua. First thing, he's going to war. First mention. And then I just want you to consider the numbers of soldiers we're talking about here. In Exodus 12:37, then the children of Israel, this is right when they're coming out of Egypt, right? Right after the final plague. Just Passover is instituted, firstborn are killed. Okay, Pharaoh says, get out of here and bless me also. We're all going to die if you stay here. Get out. Okay. Exodus 12:37. Then the children of Israel journeyed from Ramses to Succoth, about 600,000 men on foot besides children. That's that Hebrew word geber. We'll see it defined a little later, I think the next scripture. Numbers 1, 45 and 46. So all who were numbered of the children of Israel by their father's houses from 20 years old and above, all who were able to go to war in Israel, all who were numbered were 600 and 3,550. Okay. In this one it says about 600,000, this one specifies. But the number it's specifying is those men that are 20 years old, and can go to war. Okay, again, just numbers of soldiers now. We were talking about numbers, a whole group of people, but the numbers of soldiers, when Moses says to Joshua, go get some men, this is the numbers we're talking about here, right? This is what he's going to command. This is what he's going to choose. This is what he's going to marshal in order to make his battle. So Joshua was, a man's man. I mean, this guy was a man's man. Numbers 14:9. Let's read a little bit of this. If you would turn to Numbers chapter 13. We were just in Numbers 12, and we're not going to read a whole lot of this, but let's read a bit. Oh, yeah, we don't read too much here. Let's see. Let's look at Numbers 13, 31, verse 31. This is the spies when they come back. Verse 30. Then Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and take possession, for we are well able to overcome it. But the men who had gone up with him said, we are not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we. And they gave the children of Israel a bad report of the land which they had spied out, saying, the land through which we have gone as spies is a land that devours its inhabitants. And all the people whom we saw in it are men of great stature. There we saw the giants, the descendants of Anak came from the giants. And we were like grasshoppers in our own sight, and we were in their sight. They tell you their perspective, right? Right there. Their God is about that big, and therefore that's how big they are. For Joshua and Caleb, their God is big enough that it doesn't make any difference who's in the land. God promised them the land. Let's go. Right? I just want to point out one verse to you here, because it's a really cool approach in thinking of Joshua and Caleb. Numbers 14:9. Only do not rebel against the Lord, nor fear the people of the land. This is Joshua and Caleb speaking to the Israelites now. You know, this is what we want you to do. Only do not rebel against the Lord, nor fear the people of the land, for they are our bread. Their protection has departed from them, and the Lord is with us. Do not fear them. Now, the reason I point that out is this word protection is the Hebrew word shadow. Another thing I probably didn't tell you this about manna. They had a limited time to gather manna. When manna fell, they had a limited time to gather it. When the sun came up, the manna melted. Okay? That's the metaphor that Joshua and Caleb are using for what the people in the promised land, what's going to happen to them. You know, their protection, their shadow is gone. The sun's going to come down, they're going to vanish just like the manna does. Just like we see every single morning. That's what's going to happen to these people who you think are going to kick your butt. All we got to do is go in there because God is on our side. That's Joshua and Caleb's perspective. That's what that verse is talking about. It's just such a great perspective. Okay, so again, we looked a little bit there at the contrast between what the 10 spies said and what Joshua and Caleb said. By the way, Caleb was 15 years younger than Joshua. At the end of the book of Joshua, I think he's 85 when he finally kind of comes into his inheritance. Caleb is. So he's about 15 years younger or so. It's before Joshua dies. Let's just look at verse 10. I didn't put this in the presentation because this is how the people react. You got 10 guys saying you can't do it. You got two guys saying, no, piece of cake, we can do this. And this is what the people believe. Okay, Numbers chapter 14, verse 10. And all the congregation said to stone them with stones. Now the glory of the Lord appeared in the tabernacle of meeting before all the children of Israel. So the people's response to Joshua and Caleb saying, we can do this, is, okay, let's stone them. That's their response. Right? We're not going to believe it. We're not going to believe God's word. We're not going to believe that God's going to get us the promised land. Let's stone them because we don't like what they said. That was the people's response. And I think we'll... A couple things here relative to the Exodus itself that I think we'll stop for now. Just a point, as I mentioned earlier, it was never God's intention that the children of Israel wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. It was never God's intention. Let's look at Deuteronomy chapter 1. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy chapter 1. And we'll read a bit about that. How the whole spy thing came about. Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 21. We'll start in verse 19, actually. So this is, by the way, Deuteronomy is entirely Moses speaking. I think maybe 2 Timothy and Deuteronomy are my favorite books of the Bible. It's because this is entirely just Moses talking. You get to have... It's a one-sided conversation, but you get to have a conversation with Moses. It's a fabulous book. I really encourage you to read it. Anyway, verse 19. So we departed from Horeb, this is Moses speaking, and went through all that great and terrible wilderness which you saw on the way to the mountains of the Amorites, as the Lord our God had commanded us. Then we came to Kadesh Barnea. And I said to you, you have come to the mountains of the Amorites which the Lord our God is giving us. Look, the Lord your God has set the land before you. Go up and possess it, as the Lord God of your fathers has spoken to you. Do not fear or be discouraged. And every one of you came near to me and said, let's send men before us, and let them search out the land for us, and bring back word to us of the way by which we should go up, and of the cities into which we shall come. So Moses says, let's go. People say, wait. Let's send somebody in first and see what we're supposed to do. It was never God's intention for them to wander for 40 years. We're not going to read the record, but it's in, again, Numbers 13 and 14. I encourage you to read it. Sends the spies in, 10 of them not good report, 2 of them good report. People react to that. Based on the people's reaction, God says, okay, fine. You guys can die in the wilderness, the whole generation of you, the whole 600,000 men we read about, the whole 20-somethings and up that can go to war. They were the ones that didn't want to go in the promised land, that didn't want to believe the promise. Fine, you die out here. I will take your kids in that you thought were going to get killed by going into the promised land. I'm going to put them in the promised land because you didn't believe what I said. Now, another thing that's good to understand This is the route of the Exodus, right? This is Egypt. That's the Nile River. This is where the children of Israel started. And they go down here and up here. They fight here, and then they wander around here after they disobey. And they send spies into the Promised Land. That's Israel. They send spies into the Promised Land. They come back. People said, we can't do this. They end up wandering there for like 38 years before they finally get to the point of Joshua chapter 1 and going back into the Promised Land, right? Now, the reason I point all that out is, look at this scripture. Exodus 13, 17, and 18. Then it came to pass when Pharaoh had let the people go, that God did not lead them by the way of the land of the Philistines, although that was near. For God said, lest perhaps the people change their minds when they see war and return to Egypt. So God led the people around by way of the wilderness of the Red Sea, and the children of Israel went up in orderly ranks out of the land of Egypt. Okay, so where's the land, the way of the land of the Philistines? Okay, I'll show you where that is. That's where that is. Directly from where they started to where they were going. God didn't lead them that way. Why? Because they were going to get scared and go back. It was never his intention for them to wander for 38 years. It was never his intention for them to disobey and, you know, he was going to have to let that generation die in the wilderness. That was never his intention. His intention was go direct, go into the Promised Land. He deliberately didn't do that because of what he thought, and if you read the records, that's exactly what they did. They got scared. They're even sometimes when they didn't have food or water, oh my gosh, let's stone these people and go back to Egypt. How often have we done that? Individually, us, you know? I mean, it's like, there's a great old gospel song called One More Night with the Frogs. And it's about the frogs, the plague. Well, you know, the frogs are really bad. They stink like crazy, but I can do one more night. So whatever it is, you know, whatever bad habits or sin we have the same attitude. I can do one more night with it. It's fine. Yeah, just pile them over there. I'll sleep over here. Really, we all do that with something in our lives. We all do that. So anyway, God didn't do that. Now, next thing that it's important to understand, again, along the lines of God didn't intend them to wander for 40 years. Okay? This, again, is the Exodus route. They went from Egypt, down here, back up, over to the Promised Land, right? Now, Exodus 19:2. In the third month after the children of Israel had gone out of the land of Egypt, on the same day they came to the wilderness of Sinai. For they had departed from Rephidim, that's down here, and had come to the wilderness of Sinai. Now, that says 3 months. Even if you go the long route, even if God didn't send them this way because he didn't think they were going to do it, this is only 3 months, right? And then, look at this scripture, Deuteronomy 1:2. It is 11 days' journey from Horeb, that's Mount Sinai, by the way of Mount Seir, up this way, to Kadesh Barnea. 11 days. 3 months this way, 11 days that way. Even if they took the long route, they should have been there in 4 months. It was never God's intention for them to wander in the wilderness. It was because of their reaction, again, versus Joshua's reaction, their reaction to God's promise. Joshua is, we got this, man, which is why he was the one leading them into the Promised Land. And I think we'll end there, I believe. I'll be teaching next week again on Joshua 1. We'll go over some other stuff, especially the word meditate. I encourage you to start reading the book of Joshua. You might want to read some of those other records because you'll begin to see how Joshua came to be Joshua, what he went through, what he learned, what he saw.